Hello, I'm Judith Gay, Vice President for Academic Affairs at Community College of Philadelphia. Today, I have the privilege of interviewing Dr. Ralph Faris. Dr. Faris is a professor of sociology at the college. He's won numerous awards for excellence in teaching, and he's also the author of a number of publications and books. Today, we're going to concentrate on his book, Living in the Dead Zone, Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison, which he wrote, co-wrote with his brother. Welcome, Ralph.
Thank you, Judy. Pleasure to be here.
Could you tell the story of how you and your brother decided to write a book about these two music icons? Certainly, I remember both Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison from the 60s and knew that they passed away at an early age when they were both probably at the peak of their music careers.
27,
yeah. So could you talk a little bit about how you decided to write a book about those two music industry icons?
It was mostly, the decision that we made to write the book was mostly predicated on my dismissal of my brother's judgment. It was a matter-of-fact judgment about Janis Joplin. We were driving home to a family reunion, and if you've ever been on a long ride in a car and you desperately want some music.
And, so and you've got to talk.
Yeah. Well, my brother's a psychologist, so he can manage that really well. But after a while, you want some music. So we turned on the station, and there was Janis Joplin. For those of you who know the music, Me and Bobby McGee, which is one of the most, well, it's a terrific piece of music. And I remember saying to my brother, I turned to him and said, oh boy, that Janis, boy, she was some kind of character, wasn't she? And he said, yeah, and we talked a little bit, and he said, well, you know, she was a borderline personality. You know that, right? I said, my judgment is she was borderline. And he said it with a matter of fact. Now, you have to appreciate that I really, really liked Janis Joplin when I was younger. Some of my students think I'm old enough to have fought in the Persian Wars, but I'm not that old. But I'm old enough to remember Janis Joplin and how old I was when I enjoyed her music. And so I was really taken aback, and I said, what are you talking about, borderline personality? This is Janis Joplin. Are you kidding? Much the same way that we received this kind of reaction from fans who were at book signings that we did, who were taken aback that we were saying anything that could be translated as negative about their heroes. And so I said, no, it's true. And so we argued the rest of the way home about what would count for borderline and why are you making these claims about this, that, and the other thing. And I was getting defensive. So at the end of the ride, we kind of thought, well, maybe we should write up what we're doing here and maybe think about an article or something. And it turned into a book. And I guess the rest is a certain kind of history.
Well, since you introduced the concept borderline personality from your perspective, I know your brother is the clinical psychologist, but what do you know about borderline personality that could explain it to people who haven't heard that term before?
Well, it's a complicated personality disorder, and it wasn't very well known in the 60s and 70s. It has become much better understood as a result of clinical research and the kind of investigative analysis that has come since then. But essentially, a borderline personality, I mean, it has a lot of characteristic features. If you look in the DSM, which is the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, it's out in number 5, the 5th edition.
Right.
They will describe it as a failure to integrate your self-concept, the inability to form a stable self-concept. That's one. So I don't want to get too technical, but it's one kind of feature of the borderline personality. And one of the explanations as to why that is so, people don't have a profound sense of self, a stable sense of self that most people have after they've reached the age of, let's say, 15 or so. Mm-hmm. They are unable to, the two concepts that I use are splitting, which is the unstable personality, and constant object constancy, which is the inability to hold on to images of the people in your lives who would otherwise have helped you form those images. Mm-hmm. Parents, girlfriend, boyfriend, friends, and so forth. So the borderline personality is a very unstable mix of a painful experiences of not really knowing, not really having a profound sense or a clear sense of who you are, what your identity is. Mm-hmm. And that produces lots of very unacceptable behaviors, disruptive behaviors, high anxiety, depressive symptoms from time to time, and so forth, which were, as far as we're concerned with our investigations of both Janis and Jim Morrison, they characterized their behaviors about as well as anybody else we'd ever taken a look at. So And that was, by the way, when I turned the corner and I said, okay, I can still love Janis's music, but I guess I'm going to be forced to recognize that this is also true, and it doesn't, you know, undercut my desire to listen to her music and all that, but... So, that matters.
So both Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison, for people who remember their histories, had very somewhat chaotic lives, in and out of relationships, issues with drugs and alcohol. And in fact, I think there's some controversy about what exactly led to their deaths. I think most people seem to believe that drugs and alcohol were at least involved in in their deaths. So is that in and of itself what made them borderline personality, or those are just symptoms of whatever pain they were feeling as individuals?
Well, if you ask almost any psychologist, they'll quickly point to drug and alcohol abuse and what I would call arrested development, chaotic relations with other people. Those are all symptomatic features of the disorder. That they are also, unfortunately, symptomatic features of a lot of other disorders, and that's why it's important that you be in a position to carefully disentangle a borderline analysis from, let's say, a major depressive disorder or a schizoidal behavior of one sort or another, which, you know, I don't want to poke into my brother's terrain, but that's what he's best able to do. He's been doing it for 25 years. But if I take the question to be, well, what about the drugs and alcohol, and what about the other features of their behaviors, and why would you want to link them necessarily to borderline personalities? Excuse me. If they're symptomatic, that means that they are really masking. There were attempts on the part of Janis and Jim and anybody who's in that situation to control the pain. The people who are borderlines and have had therapy will define and describe their situation as being very painful, very much filled with high anxiety, very much feeling like you're alone and you're not really connecting to others and so forth. Now, if you're in that kind of situation, you might be expected to reach for something that would soothe those impulses, impulsive behavior to begin with. And so that's why we take the view in the book, and I don't think that's an extraordinary view to take. I mean, anybody that would say, oh yeah, the problem with this person is that they were an alcoholic, and to which one would ask, well, why that person and not another one? So methodologically, to talk about symptomatic features as being causes is a mistake. Mm-hmm. It's a significant mistake in research techniques to think that way. So that, I guess I'm not sure if I'm responding to your question.
No, you are.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you mentioned that you didn't want to get too far into your brother's domain, but so you're a sociologist. Let's talk about your domain. How much of their behaviors and success were related to the culture, the political, cultural climate in the United States in the 60s? Because certainly, I'm thinking in terms of fans loved the extreme behaviors that they saw, particularly in Jim Morrison, I would think.
Yeah.
That the things that he was doing on stage, people thought, oh, that shows rebellion, oh, that shows, you know, I think that there was a real acceptance of that behavior, almost as though that was part of the act, even though it was really part of their lives. So how do we separate out the impact of culture, politics in the 60s from, you know, these were individuals that might have had some problems, even if they were talented musicians?
Sure. I would say with great difficulty and carefully is how you have to separate them out. As a sociologist, I want to look back on the sociocultural upheaval. The German word is Umwälzung, which means that the entire institutional apparatus was in a state of disrepair beginning late 50s, early 60s. The 60s was one chaotic, difficult period in American history, to say the least. And one of the difficulties is that the descriptions that you've offered of people making easy judgments about Janis or Jim's behavior as being normal or okay, in fact, they actually encouraged it, was that they didn't, you know, that there was a culture of anti-authority, anti-institutional.
Right.
Louis Foyer writes a book called The Counterculture, the generation that's in conflict with the previous generation, which might be a standard. You might expect to have that occurring routinely, historically. But in the 60s, it was much more pronounced. And so there was an easy acceptance of drug use. The great leader of the drug...
Timothy Leary
is quoted by Alan Bloom in a book he wrote some time ago called The Closing of the American Mind, in which he said Leary justified his drug use. He said it was an experiment. And so Bloom asked the question, he said, okay, after 20, 25 years of drug use, so what were the conclusions of that research? What do we learn? What is it that we know about it? So that drug use that was, again, symptomatic of a sociocultural disconnect from the previous generation to the generations that were in the crowds that like Janis and Jim. So it looked normal to them. It masked, as I write in the text, a kind of a serious disorder beneath the surface of it. So, and I want to be careful, we wanted to be careful to disentangle that disorder from what any performing artist will tell you, that they have to experiment on the stage with what works. Mm-hmm. As performing artists, they don't always know what's going to work, and they're creative.
It's creative, that creative, right?
Artistic. So those tended to get pushed together in the 60s, more so than they needed to be. And in light of, you know, in retrospect, when you look back on it, you can say, well, yes, but stepping out on a stage, Jim Morrison once stepped out on a stage, and he stared at the audience for 29 minutes.
Wow.
Stared at them, and they were yelling back at him, come on, sing, do something, what's the matter with you? And he said not a word. And so I think it was Krieger or Densmore, I can't remember who wrote, that at that moment they were more terrified than they'd ever been in their lives about what was about to happen, because the crowd is 50, you know, how many thousands of people out there?
Who paid money.
Who paid money. And say, what is he doing
now?
What is this? So they would say, they thought it was part of the act, and then elsewhere in their book they'll say, but it didn't strike us as being part of an act. Nobody could possibly think of that. Now, in the text, we describe borderline personalities as, pardon me, as provocative, unnecessarily provocative, that they need that provocation to feel something that they're not able to feel. That panic, the word dead zone, refers to a kind of a panicky, alone, isolative experience that you're having. There are a lot of other ways to describe it, but that would be, trying to provoke an audience that way would be perfectly consistent with that kind of diagnosis of their behavior. Remember, we're doing this from a distance,
right,
and we're doing it from anything we could find about their lives,
right.
So I don't want to pretend that we had them in therapy, even though
right.
we have...
there's a pretend kind of interaction, therapy session for both of them. So you use the term dead zone. Where did that term come from?
Well, it actually came from patients. My brother has been treating borderlines, among other disorders, for, I guess, now 30 years since I wrote the book, so he's been motoring along there. And what he did was he asked patients if he could use the words that they use to describe
what they're experiencing.
And so there are alternative terms, but we kind of got stuck on the dead zone. It doesn't have to be the dead zone, because some patients said it's not a dead zone, it's actually a zone filled with noise. The noise of incoherence, of anxiety that comes. It's like, you know, the scene from the movie, the Alfred Hitchcock movie, Psycho, where the guy pulls back the shower curtain. I don't know if
I've seen it.
And he stabs him. And as he's stabbing this gal in the shower, the
Janet
music
Lee.
Is like a staccato, a sharp, shrill. That's how another patient described it.
Really?
So that's hardly dead. That's actually painfully scary and high anxiety inducing. So, but we settled on dead zone because that seemed to be a term that a lot of the patients used. To answer your question directly, I guess I should.
And in the 60s, people who had those experiences, there wasn't necessarily a diagnosis that fit what was going on then. So possibly a number of people went undiagnosed. In fact, one of the points that you make in the book is that if they had lived, that there might have been treatment that would have been effective for them. That might have led to a different kind of life and experience for them both.
Well, sure. I think my brother would be a good example. If you ask him what's the difference between how he treats patients now with borderline disorder, not to mention other kinds of disorders, because we've learned a lot about them as well, as opposed to what he would have done with a patient 25 years ago, he'll tell you that there's a world of difference. There is a lot of hope about what sorts of treatment processes actually work. And in various places where we've spoken, he's mentioned them, and I don't want to get too deeply into them, except, the research has revealed a lot more about the underlying manifestations of this disorder and what provokes it, what actually brings it into a more full-blown state. Mm-hmm. And so, for example, one of the treatment processes is providing borderline patients with structure. They desperately need it since they don't have a way of engaging in that structure themselves. So borderline patients, when they're married, typically have, for example, if it's a woman, they typically have a very understanding husband who, if he's going to be helpful, is going to set up rules that they have to abide by and a structure within which they can locate themselves. the focus on Janis and Jim in some ways tilts it a little bit because they're performing artists. We chose them because we thought there would be that would raise the interest generally in the population about borderlines, and maybe that would stimulate further research, which it has. Our book hasn't necessarily done that, but there has been more research. But standard the range of difference between what is known as an emotive and a detached borderline, those are two technical terms about the kinds of borderlines that you can encounter, has grown much greater since the research has been done. And so we have an idea about what to do and what would matter. And so you asked if, I think you asked, maybe I'm anticipating the question, but whether we think, my brother thinks that they could have saved their lives, and he thinks, yes, over the years you can provide the kind of help that might have prevented them from pushing alcohol or drugs to a point where they were going to kill themselves. Mm-hmm. There isn't any disagreement except among some very adoring fans about what killed Jim Morrison. Okay. You know, one at a convention, a talk I gave, said that he was convinced that the CIA had killed Jim Morrison. And so I politely excused myself and left because I didn't want to hear about robots stealing luggage and stuff like that. You know?
I think the other place that people go when they're trying to figure out why people act the way they are, as they do when they're adults, is into their childhood. So what did you learn about, let's separate them. What about Janis Joplin's childhood? Were there any things there that were suggestive of problems that she was going to have later on? Or, you know, and I think in the book, to be fair, you actually rule out that was the experiences. But could you talk a little bit about her background, and then maybe we'll talk about Jim Morrison's background, and then why you and your brother believe that that's not the answer to how they turned out as adults. But certainly there were things that that they reflected on in their past experiences that they themselves attributed to some of their behaviors.
Sure. Whatever they thought about what might be the origin of the difficulties they were having, the two of them were mostly unconscious about it. Jim Morrison later in his life had a little more awareness about the fact that it wasn't because he didn't have the right gal with him. Pamela Corson was his girlfriend. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't because of this business back. One of the mythological features of Morrison's past is that he as a child, witnessed a terrible accident on the driving accident. And some Indians were killed on the road that he drove by, and that was a traumatizing experience. In Janice's case, people are unable to point back to anything other than the fact that she was a very typical adolescent, a juvenile of a certain sort, disruptive and here and there, but no more so than you would expect to find in that age range from roughly 11 or so till about 17 or 18, when people are in the search of an identity, so to speak.
Right. And so her feeling that, I know it, she said that she felt she was treated badly in high school, that she wasn't popular, that people called her ugly. But a lot of people have that adolescent experience where they believe that.
My students say that. Yeah. Oh, I wasn't liked in high school. It was terrible. And, oh, it was so traumatic. And I say, well, you're not a borderline. Okay, let's just get that straight. Or at least I can't tell if you are, but that's not a sine qua non of borderline personality. Mm-hmm. So the line in research methodology is that you can't explain a variable with a constant. So if people are going to go back to early childhood experiences as a variable and say, yeah, well, that explains it, what it doesn't explain is people who have difficult periods in high school, God knows in the United States anyway, they're very difficult periods. Right. I don't want to comment much more on that. As a sociologist, I can look onto it. But you can't say, well, because of that difficult experience in high school, that's what generated the borderline impulses or something of that sort. Mm-hmm. Most of the research doesn't show environmental. It shows more, if it's going to show anything, and right now that research is really imprecise in terms of the origin. Mm-hmm. We can pretty much identify borderlines, but we're not quite sure what produces them, so to speak. So the research is just not available to make the definitive claims about environmental factors that might have produced or generated the syndrome, so to speak. And by the way, you ask, what about Janice's background? I'm sorry to have avoided that question, but nothing about her background would have suggested that, other than the standard adolescent ruminations, does the guy sitting next to me like me, you know, those torturous times in high school.
Mm-hmm. She grew up in kind of a middle class, somewhat conservative, religious family.
She had a very supportive mother who encouraged her musical inclinations, recognized the talent there. Her mother herself was musically inclined. And there wasn't anything, any of the literature of biographies that had been done of her, that had been written about her, or anything that we could find at home. We scoured newspaper clippings, anything back in high school yearbooks that would suggest that hostility toward the parents of any sort that might even trigger that, so to speak. We didn't expect to find anything, but we were open to the possibility. I, in particular, was, because as a sociologist, I'm inclined to view environmental factors as being significant in the production of the kind of personality that a person is. I mean, how could you not claim that environment matters? Mm-hmm. But when you're looking at somebody who's psychologically ill, in a sense, you're hard-pressed to nail any particular factor as being a defining factor of that personality, that tilt in a certain direction. Mm-hmm. So the answer is that we looked at a lot of the misconceptions that people had. Oh yeah, it must have been something back there. Their parents were abusive or something. And nobody wrote anything at all about that. Mm-hmm. I suppose you could claim, well, but if there was something back there in that family, they might have hidden it from view or something. Okay, I'm willing to acknowledge that might be so. But we couldn't find anything. Mm-hmm. And I don't think anybody has read more about the two characters than we did. Or done a greater search, and now with Google, you're able to get much more stuff.
Similarly, for Jim Morrison, kind of a middle class family, but I think there was a brief period of time, maybe after he had started to achieve some notoriety as a musician, where he was not in contact with his family. There was some kind of breach. But even that's not so unusual that people from time to time don't get along with one or more of their relatives and stop speaking for a period of time. So even that's not enough to say, clearly the family was not supportive, and that's why he turned out the way he did.
Well, in addition to that, I mean, I can't quarrel with that. Jim's father was an admiral in the Navy.
Right.
Now, if you
they
remember
moved
the
a
60s,
lot.
The 60s was a period of time when the military was not revered.
Not popular, right.
and he was part of a counterculture himself. The musical culture has become, as Bloom and Scruton and others say, it's become the spiritual inheritors of the church, for example, religion. Mm-hmm. So music is loomed large for kids who grew up in the 60s. And it was a counterculture, which meant that almost everything about it screamed, they're lying to you, don't trust adults over 30, that kind of thing. So it wouldn't be surprising that he would look on his father, for example, as an admiral in the Navy, as, part of that apparatus out there that's oppressing people or whatever it might be. By the way, I don't mean to make light of that at all, because God knows you can have whatever feelings about the 60s you wish. But if you're asking, is there something about Jim Morrison's family that's out of the ordinary that you would look at and say, I wonder if that isn't the source of the borderline syndrome. I don't think you can get there from here. Mm-hmm. At least that's our analysis.
Now you were a fan. You talked about listening to their music as you were leading a platoon in Vietnam. So what was it about their music that attracted you? And I also want to ask you about, because you did some research on their fans. You did interviews with the fans.
Okay.
I wanted to kind of understand. Because I would consider myself a fan of Janis, particularly Janis Joplin, not so much Jim Morrison.
Yeah.
I liked the music, didn't think he had a particularly strong voice, but her voice was unique in my mind. And I loved her bluesy sound. So what was it that attracted you as a fan? Why were you a fan? And what did you learn about the fans of Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison? You mentioned earlier that there are some fans that don't want to hear anything bad about them. So you're clearly not in that category. Why a fan? And what have you learned about fans of people like Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison?
Okay, that's a fair question, or a set of questions. You have to bear in mind that 40 years ago, I was a young fellow. I know, again, my students think I'm 150 years old, but. When I was 20, the music that came out of Janis Joplin's band and her voice struck me as being robust, filled with energy, and I'm filled with energy myself, and I was sympathetic to the song, the lyrics of the music. And she was, if you've ever seen her in performance,
I think
the most dynamic performer you're ever going to find. It was an honest dynamism on the stage, in my judgment. So I'm giving you a kind of a post,
she
a retrospective
look. She was all into
the
music.
Back.
She was really singing those songs.
Oh,
you felt every note of those songs.
She said in her writings that, at least as she's quoted by her biographers, that she wouldn't sing anything she didn't feel. So, I mean, how could you... Unless, you know, you're turned off by any of the pop music to begin with, which I wasn't. I was 20 years old or so, 18 years old when I started listening to Janis, and I thought, oh, God, she's terrific. This is wonderful. Now, I listened to Jim Morrison's, because Janis Joplin was a dynamic, a performing artist as you're ever going to see on a stage. Mm-hmm. There might be others who were as good, but she and Morrison were, as you might remember, the king and queen of rock and roll. Mm-hmm. And, so when they're at the top of that game and you see them and you feel that, I only attended one concert where Janis performed, but that was enough. I mean, the music I was already inclined toward to begin with, but in any case, Jim Morrison is a completely different animal in the sense that you're right. I think you're right about the voice, but I don't want to be a music aficionado.
No, I'm not either, but I know what I like.
I liked the songs that he wrote because the songs that he wrote had, well, I like the melodies, number one. Come on, baby, light my fire. If you're 19, for God's sake, if you don't like that one, there must be something wrong with you. But he had another one, and the one that I have in mind is the one that came over this boom box that we had with us in Vietnam, People Are Strange.
Oh, yeah.
If you know the music. We're in the, it's pitch black, 2 a.m, and there's a firefight going on in the distance, not us, but there are tracer rounds going back and forth in the middle of this darkness, and somebody hit a button, and out comes People Are Strange, and I thought... Well, this fits everything that I've had to experience
sums it all
in this
up,
crazy
right?
place called Vietnam. Not an experience I enjoyed, but I mean the experience of being there. So, there was a second part of the question.
So you're a fan. How was the fan like you different from, and what did you find out about the fans when you did your interviews?
Well, that's where I think my sociology training, if I may say, came into play because I over the years that we've done this, where we've actually interviewed fans, I've come to see that they should be stratified. They should be categorized into different elements. Mm-hmm. So there are the adoring, no matter what he does, he's next to God kind of fan. Mm-hmm. And that's the one you have to be careful with because they were taken aback that they initially thought a presentation by the two Faris brothers about Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison, it's going to be great. We'll hear a lot about Jim Morrison. But what they heard was, we loved his music, but he was sick. He was, in a sense, not in his right mind in some ways. And that tended to put off the adoring fans who wanted to hear nothing at all that you could possibly translate as criticism, other than, I want him to write more music, you know, or something of that sort. So one character at one of the book signings that we went to said, we had presented the information about the borderline status, and he said, he raised his hand, and I said, yes. He said, well, I just want you to know that I liked Janis just the way she was. And so my brother's inclined to be sympathetic there. I'm a little more direct. And I said, oh, I'm pleased that you found Janis's music to your liking. I did too. I guess that you also don't mind that she died at the tender age of 27 then. She ended up killing herself at 27. That was okay with you too then. And he just looked at me as if I had said something that was insulting.
Heresy.
I said, the fact, and you get other kinds of questions from fans. So that's one kind of fan, the adoring fan that won't hear any criticism. There are others who simply like the music, and I wouldn't want to leave the viewers with any impression that people who like Jim Morrison's music must also themselves be borderlines. There are different levels of relating to music, and so people fell into various categories. They like that kind of music, and they recognize, in a sense, the genius and the creativity that went into the creation of that music, along with Janis's stuff, either the music, the ensemble, the arrangement of the music, or something like that. And so they liked it. They didn't know much of anything else about her, but they thought maybe they would learn something. And so you get lots of different kinds of fans. And by the way, those fans are out there on the internet.
Right, it's amazing.
You can find 100 different sites for Janis's music and the same for Jim Morrison's. Jim Morrison fans tend to be a bit on the moody side, the way Morrison was, but not always. I mean, that's a pattern that we tended to recognize that. So, that dark breaking through to the other side, that's what we refer to in the text as that detached borderline, who is the dark and desperate and the depressed side of the borderline. And Janis was on the other side, the hysterical, emotive side. One of the reasons I was attracted to her was that she was about as alive a person on a stage as you're ever going to see. I mean, was an unbelievable outpouring of energy. You just don't see that often, except with crazy people, you know, Arrested Development. But this was a performing artist that. So I think that's what you would find. They would challenge your view of the analysis that you're running of the borderline status of their favorite singer. Mm-hmm. Or they would ask questions about whether they felt self-conscious. Well, I like the music. Does that mean I'm a borderline or something like that? And then there were other categories. I don't know if you want to go into them or not. But
so were there other people that you considered using for the, but when you started the project with your brother, was your intention to kind of look at a number of people who people could identify with or were familiar with, and as a way of getting out more information about borderline personality? Or did you always start with just Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison? You heard them on the radio, and those were the two from the beginning that you wanted to write about. Mm.
Initially I was just fighting my brother's analysis because it was my one of the ones.
Your brothers.
That's right. But we, you know, slowly began to think about why we would write this book. Mm. And I said, well, in the first place, so I can tell you that you're all wet. There's no way this could be true about Janis Joplin. But more importantly, that it would be a kind of a helpful manual for people who are living with borderlines. Mm-hmm. And or it might be picked up by departments in psychology that want to have examples, and because the faux therapy sessions revealed how they actually would respond in a therapy session. Mm-hmm. Had 25 years of experience with it, so the inside of that experience really mattered. And so we decided that we would push for a more popular text, because as the text became known, we got letters from people who would say, that's my brother, sister, mm-hmm. husband, wife, whatever. Can you help me? My mm-hmm. brother would get those sorts of calls. Mm-hmm. And so we saw that it was resonating, and that we would try to do what we could to spread that word, that consciousness, that you're not dealing with just a bleakly crazy person. You're dealing with a particular disorder that's now about which there's more known. And so we kind of took it as a project for raising consciousness. Mm-hmm. And so my brother's interest was in getting people to therapy. My interest was in getting funding for it, in a sense, by getting the institutions that are responsible for mental health to pay closer attention to it, because the costs of not paying attention to it, it's a lot like environmental, you know,
right.
You're paying court costs. You have to prosecute people of that sort. They die early. They leave a tremendous chaos in the lives
wake,
of the people
yes.
around them.
Right.
Everybody around them is affected by it. And so it not only costs money, but it costs time and energy, and there's a lot of suffering out there that doesn't need to happen or could be
alleviated.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's why we decided mm-hmm. to flip it over and make it a popular text rather than mm-hmm. a technical text. We sent it to the editor once as a technical text, and he mm-hmm. said, oh, that's terrific. I'm sure that psychologists will enjoy it, but nobody else will, because right. they don't know what the heck you're talking about.
So the message won't get out. So.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
but why Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison only? I mean, presumably there were other people who were borderline personality at that in the same time period, or in more recent times. What was it about those two that meant the book really should only focus on those two?
Yeah, well,
or was it just sheer time to do the research? I mean, you put a lot of time in researching those
two.
Yeah.
Well, it was a labor of love initially, mm-hmm. because I liked the music, and my brother was not hostile to it either, mm-hmm. and had an interest in borderline since he'd been working with them. There are certainly plenty of other characters that we could have pulled into the text, but we thought, since these two were the most well-known, they were the king and queen of rock and roll, and that an aging population would be more inclined to take this diagnosis to heart and take a close look at relatives, you know, close people close to them, and try to do something with it. So we just made a judgment. Maybe it was wrong. I don't know. Who knows? But we made a judgment that the two would be standard bearers. They would mm-hmm. they would generate a lot of interest. But we had to write the book quickly, because a lot of the people who would remember Janis and Jim were
might
not around.
Not be around, right? Yeah.
40 years ago, for good size, you know.
Do you think the book resonates at all with a younger generation, people who didn't live while Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison? Now, I know you said there are lots of sites, and certainly people that are interested in music, you know, don't kind of judge just by the time period. So I know lots of younger people that listen to music that was popular when I was listening to a lot of contemporary music. So does it resonate? Did you talk about your book in your classes at all? Did it,
I have,
or even as to the approach to how a sociologist approaches the topic?
If I do talk about it in class, it has to be connected to the sociology, because I teach sociology, so it would be connected to the sociology of it. But, you know, it's hard for me to generalize, because I've seen a lot of people who wanted to talk to me about the book, and it actually has been translated into French, which...
Because Jim Morrison's buried
in Paris. Pierre Lachaise Cemetery, mm-hmm. Sure. But there seems to be a greater number, as far as I can tell, of people in France, young people in France, who are interested in this book than there is in the United States, because I think the bottom line is that the younger folks know the music. I mean, my own son knew the music, and he's a big music aficionado, and so he said, oh yeah, man, me and Bobby McGee. And so you would find the kids who like the music, and who, if they are at all introspective, and that would be mostly college students, who find the analysis of either one of them, either it's Jim Morrison or Janis, to be compelling. So they might pick up the book and then get lost in it and so forth. Mm-hmm. But I think it'll be a relatively smaller number. By far, we've gotten more responses from people who are living with borderlines.
Okay.
And I always give those people my brother's address or a telephone number, because I can't tell them what to do except to get to somebody that knows something about borderlines. My brother knows a lot about borderlines. Mm-hmm. No question that if you have somebody in your family that's a borderline, contact my brother. Mm-hmm. He'll send you to somebody.
Well, it sounds like the book achieved the purpose that you set out for, to get people to know a little bit more about it. But I have to say, I thoroughly enjoyed reading it. It brought me back to the period of time when I was very familiar with the music, familiar with the actors, the people involved in the situation. Yeah, but really did provide. You know, my background's in psychology too, but I'm an experimental. My background's experimental psychology. I'm not a clinician, so it really did give me a chance to think about, okay, what was it in that behavior that does fit in terms of that diagnosis? And I learned quite a bit about borderline personality from the book. So
it's very controversial. The DSM itself is controversial, right. But initially, as evidence began to mount that there was such a disorder. People would complain that we get as you probably already know, you get a host of symptoms and you link it to some category that you invent or something like that. And in fact, at one of the signings that we did, and I think it was in Bethesda, Maryland, one person rose and said that she thought the categories of mental health were all baloney and not really relevant and so forth, that there really aren't people who are mentally disturbed.
The people are just using that as an excuse for bad behavior. I think that's the way some people think
about
it.
Like that. Yeah, they have superficial reads of what counts for these categories. And, you know, you have to be careful with people of that sort, because I'm not sure what would appeal to them. What we have to say is, okay, would you like to be in a room, the same room with the guy, The Silence of the Lambs, the movie. You think he's okay too? There's something wrong with him. Okay, so there is a placeholder for something that's, you would say, is insane behavior, or a behavior that indicates a personality disorder. So how about another? And you start sliding them over to other. If you think it's worth it, but.
To spend the time kind of trying to influence that person's thinking, so.
Yeah, in fact, we got letters from people who are hostile to the book. Who claim that this is baloney, nobody can do psychoanalysis from a distance, which we acknowledge in the text is difficult, but people have done it and done well at it. Not that I'm making any great claims for our book, but that people have done it. The actual activity of doing that is worth doing. But he was hostile and claimed that all the categories, and went far beyond saying you can't do that, that psychology itself is filled with superficial categories that can't be sustained. You know, I'm sure you've heard that.
Right, absolutely. So have you and your brother talked about doing other work together?
Well, we have in a way. He has just published another book called The Melody of the Mind with another therapist that he's worked with. I unfortunately had to edit the book, I think, I want to make a pitch, it's much more difficult to edit a book than to write it. You can write it. My brother is not somebody who types well, so he uses for those of you who know the difference between a tab and a carriage return, if you're typing and trying to edit somebody's work of that sort, it's just a magnificent headache. But it is, in fact, a description of what it is that counts for a good therapist, what the characteristic features are of somebody who understands the mind of another person. And the title of the book, Melody of the Mind, is of that sort. And of late, he's been pressing me to entertain doing another one of these borderline personality books, only with modern characters, there's a bunch out there. So, I won't mention anything.
We won't say that for the book.
Well, I don't know about the legalities of it, but some of them are dead already, so I don't have to worry about lawsuits coming at me, but that kind of thing.
So other things that you personally, rather than the push from your brother, are there things personally that you're working on professionally that are of particular interest to you now, besides the Phillies?
No. Well, there isn't anything beside the Phillies. Let's actually, what I'm working on is collecting data about the costs of mental health. The Reagan Revolution in the 1980s sort of decentralized the mental health institutions. And I'm not saying it was a good or bad idea, but there is just ample evidence that the people that we're seeing on the street and in big cities and so forth really need some help. And so I'm trying to gather the data as I can about what the costs are of not doing anything about it. Mm-hmm. Mayor Nutter here in Philadelphia is doing his best to deal with the people on the street, particularly in the winter when there's. Mm-hmm. But that's, and that's a relatively small amount of money that's dedicated to it. But the cost in terms of criminal behavior or the cost to the state and the local governments for housing or other sorts of things mm-hmm. can really add up in a hurry. Mm-hmm. And I would like to see a policy that gets ahead of that curve so that we're doing something in a way that is going to be more advantageous to pulling people in and away from the harm that they're likely to encounter on the street, for example. Mm-hmm. So there's that kind of mm-hmm. concern on my part.
So again, bringing the sociology to kind of an applied and a broad perspective on what's going on in our society.
Empirical work. I like to mm-hmm. collect data. Mm-hmm. I'm like Harry Truman. Show me the data. Show me. I want to see it. And then I'll massage it and deal with it and try to analyze it. And the data on borderline personalities is startling, really. We once did a little run ourselves, my brother and I, mm-hmm. on the costs, and what we came up with was a multiplier effect. I don't know if you multiply effect means one borderline affects how many people
how many
and what
people,
the costs
right.
are. Well, it's something like 7 to 1 if you wow. take into account court costs and court, judges, police. And I guess political people in the various positions, mayors, governors, and what have you. And then family members, more important right. than anything else. It's like 7, for every one person, there's 7 people affected. Mm-hmm. That pushes it beyond the 10 or 15% and up to like 20 or 22%. Mm-hmm. That's large enough as a problem to have an impact that you might want to pay some attention to
right.
it, you know.
Okay. Well, thank you again. I really enjoyed the conversation.
Well, thank
I
you.
Appreciate your coming in to talk about the book and about borderline personality and what we can all learn from that. So thank you very much.
Well, thank
and
you
and tell your brother
to.
Also how much I appreciated the work.
I'll pass that on to him. Thank you.
And thank you all for joining us. Please come again to see another interview.